over, so I've had the illusion. I think it's still okay. It's over February, yeah. It's mainly delighted to be able to offer most of you the opportunity to return to us for a much awaited delight and treat in our calendar. I was going to say, well, he needs no introduction, but of course I am going to introduce you to our speaker this afternoon, Dr. Alex Woolf, who's a senior lecturer at the University of St Andrews. And many of you, I'm sure, will be familiar with his composite, complete, and very fine academic arguments for the reciting of the poetry into the Highlands, into the Murray Firth. Alex was awarded a joint honours degree in medieval English and medieval history at Sheffield in 1989. And this was followed by an MPhil by research in the archaeology of Ireland in the 5th and 6th centuries. Remaining at Sheffield, Alex embarked upon a doctoral study looking at ethnic replacement in sub-Roman Britain before being appointed to a lectureship in archaeology at the University of Wales, Lampeter, in 1995. 2 years later, he took up a lectureship in Celtic and early Scottish history and culture at the University of Edinburgh, where he remained until 2000. And since 2000, Alex has been first a lecturer and later a senior lecturer in history at the University of St Andrews. I don't want to say too much more because we have really waited an extremely long time, Alex, for you. 4 months. It's been quite an advent. And we're delighted that you're with us this afternoon. May I do more than ask you to give a warm hand of welcome to you.
Well, thank you very much, Kate, and I hope we can live up to the hype. And I apologise to anybody who was here when I failed to make it before Christmas due to illness. Yes, as Kate mentioned, my arguments about reciting the Pictish Kingdom of Fortriu to the Murray Firth area, probably the inner part of the Firth, including the Black Isle and the opposite shore, back in 2006. I have to admit, when I first made that suggestion, I didn't really expect anyone would believe me or thought that maybe one or two of my friends might. But it seems to be rather surprisingly, rather quickly accepted by a rather large number of people. I'm still always dreading that someone is going to come up with the counter argument and going to move it back to Menteith and Strathern or some other tedious place in the South Sea. But for the time being, remains up here. And it says up here, I think probably about early Scottish history, that one can move whole kingdoms and provinces around. And it's partly about the problem of Scottish history and some of the issues that I want to start here. This is a little steep, press for 3 seconds.
Or press the middle, and it should go
there we are. Christopher Wickham is retiring at the end of this year as the Professor of Medieval History at the University of Oxford, and he is one of the leading historians of the early Middle Ages and has probably to a large extent revolutionised a lot of what we believe about it. And about the same time I was publishing my article on Fortriu, he published this gargantuan book of about 1400 pages, I think, called Framing the Early Middle Ages, dealing with the period 400 to 800 and the transformation of the Roman world into the medieval world. And this quotation, which I probably rather unfairly picked out, but which inevitably struck me as I was reading his book, is, "I shall not discuss the kingdoms was now Scotland, however, the post-Roman history of Britannia is already complicated enough." Elsewhere in the same book, he makes a couple of other excuses for why he's not dealing with Scotland. About the same time, or a year or two later actually, I was down in Oxford at a conference organised by Leslie Abrams and Peter Heather, and during one of the coffee breaks, Chris Wickham was asking me about my forthcoming book, which has now come forth, From Pictland to Ullaba, and said, "I do hope you'll find something to say about early Scottish history other than pointing out scribal errors in king lists." And I think to some extent, this does show the way that Scottish history is certainly perceived outside of Scotland, and which has a little truth to it, in that it does still seem often to be a catalogue of kings and battles. As one of our own great historian colleagues for Scottish history, Barbara Crawford, has said in print, a list of people with funny names killing each other. So, in a way, what this very brief paper is a kind of response to try and come up with talking about Scottish history in the way that someone like Chris Wickham might want us to. Now, Wickham is a self-identified Marxist historian who believes that the deep economic processes are what's important, and that great men are just surfing on the top of these waves of cultural and economic force that rise and fall. So he's interested in things like the whether or not the, you know, he's sort of believes the Roman Empire broke down through economic unsustainability rather than through barbarians winning particular battles. And he's the kind of person who's interested in the re-emergence of towns, the re-emergence of long-distance trade, and how control of the forces of production and so on are a real driving force of history. And of course, it is very difficult for those of us in the northern parts of Europe to look into these, because literacy and the came relatively late, and in countries that suffered very heavily from the Protestant Reformation, the survival of what was written down remained relatively limited. Our best evidence for people manipulating and controlling the means of production is actually probably a high quality sculpture that people like Henderson's in the back and Victoria here at the front have written about. But that remains alone really to show in a completely uncontroversial way that there must have been mechanisms for controlling resources, for allowing people to develop specialist skills in the way that we're used to imagining in other parts of Europe. There are no great early medieval cities, there's no great books and bits surviving from this period. So, early medieval Scotland as a world of kings and battles. What I want to talk about briefly here is about the changing relationship and balance of power and influence in the north of Britain between Dalriada, the nascent Scottish kingdom, if you like, Irish or Gaelic-speaking, depending on your sort of political view as much as anything else, down here in Argyll and the Southern Hebrides, which seems to have dominated the north in the record that was left to us in the decades around 600, so most of the 6th and much of the 7th century, and the switch to the importance of the northern Pictish territories, Fortriu, which from the late 7th century onwards seemed to have been much more the dominant power, so that we see by the middle of the 8th century, Dalriada has almost faded away. And so this is really what I want to talk about, and to see whether we can build this into some sort of we can build into this narrative some sort of underlying structure, because it's often presented simply as heroic kings of one side or another, a great king emerges and wins lots of battles and so on. And that's a very traditional narrative, but it's still a narrative that tends to dominate a lot of this kind of Scottish history, partly because of the source material. And it's the sort of thing that leads a lot of archaeologists to try and move away from narrative altogether and just look at what you can tell about lifestyles and techniques and technology from the archaeological record. So, first thing to note is actually to note the location of these two kingdoms, and that's why I've got a slightly more detailed map here. They're at either end of the Great Glen. And, of course, famously, it's during the late 6th century that St. Columba appears here, and we have, written 100 years later, an account of his life by Adamman, also the Abbot of Iona, about Columba's lifetime, and a lot of that seems to be about communications up the Great Glen with Pictish kings and territories up here, but also references to movements into the Upper Tay Basin as well. But we get a sense of this being a major artery in this period. And it's interesting that nearly all our textual evidence from this period of Scotland seems to originate from chronicles that were originally kept on Iona, parts of which were then incorporated into Irish chronicles like the Annals of Ulster and the Annals of Tiernoht and so on in the slightly later period. So it seems as if we have almost all the material in the Irish chronicles, not all of it, but almost all of it, up to about 740s, seems to originate from chronicles kept here. And it's noticeable that the only bit of Eastern Britain that they show an awful lot of interest in is up here. Briefly, Bernicia, the northern part of Northumbria during the period when there's an Ionian mission at Lindisfarne. But otherwise, it's this region here. And I think this pays tribute to that. We've got this extremely important corridor through here, much more significant than crossing the Central Highlands, and much safer than sailing around the top, going back to Cape Roth and through Pendleton Firth, as I'm sure you're aware, is not for the faint-hearted. So these are the things that I want to focus on, is this shifting balance of power. So here we are. See lots of flat, good agricultural land around here, relatively speaking. Something we tend to forget, I mean, maybe people who actually live here don't forget this, but we've moved into an era from the late 19th century onwards of much more specialist agricultural focus in different areas, where you get areas like East Anglia where it's all grain now, and areas like Wales where there's hardly any arable, and so on. But of course there would have been, before roads, railways, refrigeration, those kinds of markets, there would have been arable and livestock everywhere. And of course that means that these areas here, which on a global scale, even on a British scale, may not seem so important, are actually very important in terms of grain production, because their hinterland doesn't really have any option of getting anything from elsewhere. I mean, you've got the same down here, Angus and Blythe, really. These are the kind of breadbaskets of Scotland at this period. And as I argued in my article about Macbethan's family, the Murray question, 2000, probably this area only began to lose its importance as the southern part of the kingdom expanded south and forth in the late 10th or maybe the 11th and 12th centuries, so that you get the wealth of Lothian added on to the wealth of Fife and Angus. But prior to that, the Tay Basin and the Inner Murray Firth were probably very similar in terms of their productivity and importance. So, kings and battles. This is actually what we know. These are some examples from the Annals of Ulster of the career of Aidan MacGavran, the King of Dalriata, from 574 to sometime in the early 7th century, a slight disagreement about when his reign ended, probably 606. And there's also much debate about the exact dates of some of these battles, but they're within a year or two. When we're talking about 1500 years ago, that doesn't really matter, given a year or two in principle. Aidan MacGavran is the king who interacts most with St. Columba. He's not the king who gives Columba his Iona. Iona was founded by his predecessor, Conall, son of Corkel, who was also his first cousin. When Conall dies, his close relatives are killed by Aidan and his relatives, and then Aidan kills some of his own close relatives, and ends up as king. And what we see in his reign is this extreme range suddenly, or so it appears, and uniquely for the period. We see Dalriata stretching its arm out across the whole of modern Scotland, really. 518 leads an expedition to Orkney. In 582, the Battle of Manu, which is probably that's probably the Manow, the area that gives its name to Clackmannanshire and Slemannan, near the head of the Forth. The Battle of Kirken, which although Aidan's sons were killed, he actually seems to have won. And it's usually argued that Kirken is somewhere in the Angus region, although that's probably the least well located of these territories. And he was also famously involved in the Battle of Daghestan, in the Annals of Ulster called the Battle Against the English, but also mentioned in some detail by Bede, which is somewhere in the area of the modern borders, probably, although again debated. Traditional site is Dorston and Liddesdale, but most people don't really believe that anymore, but it hasn't come up with a consensus. But it's somewhere, obviously, between Dalriata and Lindisfarne, probably. It's that sort of area. So this brings Dalriata onto the stage as a major player. And this is this is Argyle. At what other point in history is somewhere like Argyle punching above its weight to this extent? It's an interesting time as well, because it's not the only area that is really doing this. In Ireland, Donegal up here, the land of St. Columba's own family, Ken O'Connell, out in the Northern Inale, are also the dominant force. And again, that's an area which is usually thought to be fairly marginal in terms of population, wealth, and so on. So this period in the certainly second half of the 6th century, and maybe going a bit earlier, seems to be a period of dominance. And it goes on into the early 7th century. The Ken O'Connell dynasty lose their power as the dominant dynasty in 642. Aidan's son, Yachith Gui, Yellow Yachith, continues as a leading power into the 620s, but his son, Donald Vreck, loses out in the 640s. So up until about the 640s, this dynamic of this kind of North Channel area being a dominant area continues. By contrast, by the end of the 7th century, we suddenly see something different happening. And again, this is usually presented as being down to a single individual, Bride, son of Daly, the Pictish king. Slightly confusing, because this, in our narratives about St. Columba, the king who met him was always called Bride, and it just happens that by coincidence, the two kings who reigned at the same time as Adamman was writing the life of St. Columba were also both called Bride. It's a common Pictish name if you're a king, apparently. But it is slightly confusing. But this is a different one. Anyway, we're talking in 681, there's a siege of Dunottar. This is usually attributed to him. 682, he certainly laid waste to Orkney. In 683, there's a siege of Dundurn in Upper Strathern. This is And then in 685, he wins the Battle of Nectonsmere against the Northumbrians, against his cousin Edfrid, King of Bernicia, and effectively drives the English south of the Forth. So this is one of the most important battles in Scottish history, probably. The Fife might have ended up in Northern England, had this not been the case. We don't know quite how far the control was, or to what extent it was simply overlordship, or actually English settlers, but you never know. And certainly the English bishopric that had been set up at Abercorn for jurisdiction over some or all of the Picts was abandoned, and Bishop Trumbly fled down to Whitby, which was about here, I think. Am I good? Is that Whitby more or less? Just getting to the range of what I can actually see clearly when you get down to the Norse recording. So then into the 8th century, we see a continuing dominance of fortitude in these dynamics, including a series of attacks on Dalriata in the 740s. The Pictish king, Anast, son of Urdwist, is said to smite Dalriata. The Latin word used is percussio, so you get a sense of what that is. And after that, we barely hear about Dalriata again. You go for long periods where there's no historical events, or where kings are simply mentioned as dying, they're not involved in major politics. And then when the Vikings turn up in 839, their major attack on Fortriu, Aedh son of Boabdil, the king of Dalriata, is in the army of the kings of Fortriu when they're defeated. So it seems that for most of the period after the middle of the 8th century, Dalriata has become, if not part of the Pictish kingdom, as Thomas Clancy has actually suggested in Amelia Waterford Strabo's account of the martyrdom of Glatma, at least a sub-kingdom or a place that's tributary or very much secondary. Probably, as with many early medieval overlordships, the extent of overlordship fluctuated depending on a variety of factors, how comfortable the overking was feeling at home, how strong he was. At the beginning of his reign, he might not extend his power into the edges of his territory quite so well, but as he got his feet under the table and so on. So we should imagine Dalriad having had brief moments of feeling the pressures off. But certainly, what we're seeing from the late 7th and into the 8th century and onwards, right up to the sort of crisis caused by the Vikings in the 9th century, where they effectively completely changed the game. I think writing about southern England in the Viking Age. It's suggested, but I think it's, who was it who said, Steve Bassett, I think, who produces a complicated football league analogy for the growth of the English state in the Anglo-Saxon period. And he says the cup final looked like it was set to be between Mercia and Northumbria, but they were both put off their game by a rowdy pitch invasion by Danish spectators. And you can make a similar sort of analogy for what's happening up here, this kind of struggle between Pictavia or Fortune and Dorota, which the men of Fortune seem to have been easily winning, was kind of thrown open by the Viking invasions in the early 9th century. So it's interesting, in fact, for much of the 9th century, the Dorota was not mentioned at all in the Irish Annals. So it's obviously such an insignificant place or somewhere that's tied in entirely to other polities that people don't think about it. So what I want to do in order to approach the Chris Wickham's views, if you like, and try and think about this as something other than the fact that either MacGavran was a great king and was a great hero and capable of beating lots of enemies, and then 100 years later, Brede Celebele had the charisma and the macho stances, is to try and think about why these things are sustained over time, why they change, what were the advantages and the changes. And this brings us to much more Wickham-esque thinking. In the 5th to 7th century, during the period when the Rhineland, Eastern Gaul, the whole of this area here, the North Sea, was full of barbarians milling about, destroying the Roman Empire, pirates in the North Sea on their way to becoming English and worse. The main access to exotic goods coming into Britain and Ireland was via the west coast, coming through the Straits of Gibraltar. And what this map shows is the source of various things. So this map is specifically about Tintagel, but you'll see the same kind of trade moves on elsewhere and passes on into the rest of Britain, more in the southwest, obviously closer to the territory. Probably the southwesterners were able to exploit metal. You've got lead in the contarts and tin down in Cornwall and so on. And we're able to identify archaeologically what's turning up. It's wine jars from the Syria-Turkish border area, wine from the Aegean, so-called Phocian red slipware, olive oil, it's coming from Tunisia, and glassware from the far south of Spain, and later on a little bit of glassware from the Bordeaux region as well. And this material is coming up what have been termed the Western Seaways, perhaps being re-transported, but perhaps not, into other ships, and then travelling up this way. And indeed, in Adam's Life of Columba, one of the stories he tells about Columba is that he's in Kintyre, and there's a ship of traders there from Gaul. And these are almost certainly people who have come from Bordeaux or the mouth of the Loire as part of this trade. And most of this material is found dotted around the west coast. And then as we move into the late 6th and 7th century, a lot more of the material seems to come from Western France, this stuff called e-ware, and it comes from somewhere around here. There's some debate about whether the Loire Basin or the Bordeaux region is the main area, but essentially it's from Atlantic France, if that were Bay of Biscay region. And we see a lot of this moving into this area and a lot more coming into Scotland. And it's very likely that it's these prestige goods, things like, because they're not just importing wine jars, as occasionally you have to remember to point this out, that the wine jars are there because they're importing wine. And wine is, of course, one of the things that kings and rulers can use to develop status and power. And as late as the Statutes of Iona in the early 17th century, one of the things that James VI does to try and curb the power of Highland chiefs is he limits the amount of wine they're allowed to buy every year to one barrel a year. So they can't have a hall full of drunken young men being sung to in about heroic lays and things, so they can be persuaded to do incredibly dangerous and stupid things at particular times of the year. which is how these warlord societies operate. But you also need to think about what's going the other way. And this has always been one of the problems, because we're not, archaeologists in Turkey are not finding lots of things that are obviously Scottish. There's probably reasons for that. One is that, and this is always a problem when looking at medieval trade, one problem is that we're very dependent on things that survive, and very high quality pottery and glass are things that you will spot very easily. I was talking to Victoria about this in the train as well, that if a farmer is ploughing a field, even if he's not very interested in archaeology, if he turns up a Mediterranean red slip jar of ours, he'll notice it and might even mention it to somebody. Whereas he's not going to notice a slight change in the colour of the soil because there's been a wooden building there. So very frequently we're actually drawn to other features like roundhouses and things. Wonderful roundhouses that Fraser Hunter's been excavating around Spiney and Birmingham, in Murray, were found because somebody found a pot of silver coins. And that then led archaeologists to look around and see, were these just in the middle of nowhere? And so he then found an Iron Age settlement. The likelihood is no one would have noticed the remains of the house had it not had the silver coins in it. So there's a problem here. Durable, shiny stuff is what archaeologists find. And so what we can probably say is the material that's going back down this way was not shiny and perhaps not durable. And if we think about things that have exported in other periods, smoked salmon and leather are major factors. But if we think about the sorts of things that were in high demand in the early Middle Ages, and if we think about the long-distance military raiding that Aidan was engaged in, places like Orkney and so on, we can also perhaps think about slaves going in the other direction. And we do know slaves were coming from the British Isles in the late 6th century, because famously, Gregory the Great's decision to send a mission to convert the English was because he met some English slave boys who he thought were particularly beautiful for sale in a market in Rome. And you've got to ask yourself who captured them, who these people allegedly from East Yorkshire. But since our account of this story was written in East Yorkshire, that might have been added there. And it allows a nice pun that Gregory's alleged to have made, that they were taken from Day Era, that is the anger of God. So it's a Latin pun. But they were certainly English slave boys, and there's other accounts of slaves from the British Isles turning up in these areas. So it may well be that Aidan's military capacity was not because he was a particularly great warrior, but because he had motivation and need, that if he could maximise his own wealth in the movable things in Scotland, perhaps largely slaves, perhaps cattle as well, he could engage in this trade which had begun to creep up the Irish Sea, and by the late 6th century was coming further up, and he was seeing how his southern neighbours were getting all this wine and olive oil and maybe fish sauce and probably other things, because these are things we can see, and we should probably imagine the other sorts of things that would be coming from this area would be things like high quality textiles, perhaps even silk, papyrus coming from the Nile, and many other consumer goods that were still being made in the Mediterranean, the late antiquity, the period when the Roman Empire was crumbling in Atlantic Europe, but where most of the structures of the Roman world survived in the Mediterranean, particularly in the southern and eastern Mediterranean. So it's very likely that it's this trade and a willingness or desire to engage in it and to be part of it that led to the thriving of Dalriada and perhaps also for Kenil Connell up here and these northern Irish areas. Another area that seems to be very important briefly in this period is the what's sometimes called the real Ulster. Modern-day County Down, the Kingdom of the Ulith, who give their name to the province of Ulster, but who were focused there. And they seem to have been a major power in the 6th and 7th centuries, but to very rapidly, from the mid-7th century, disappeared. And there are reasons for this. What happened to the eastern and southern Mediterranean in the course of the 7th century? This is the period in which the Arabs, recently converted to Islam, burst into the scene. It's also a period when there's, in the early 7th century, there's an attempt by an African claimant to seize the Roman Empire, which is now based around Istanbul. But essentially, we see the Mediterranean falling to warfare, but also we shouldn't think that the Arabs are destroying everything. They were mostly attracted by the wealth, but it gets redirected. This material is now going back to Damascus and later Baghdad and so on, and perhaps other areas in the interior. So we're seeing the Eastern Mediterranean, Eastern and Southern Mediterranean being refocused and less trade going across. We're crossing in the early 8th century, the Arabs even crossed the Southern Sea and briefly controlled much of it. And this was noticed by chroniclers in Britain and Ireland as well. So this is not an obscure thing that nobody knew about. Indeed, Adamnan, in his other less well-known book, he wrote The Life of Lumber, but he also, a few years earlier, wrote a book called De Locis Sanctis, on the holy places, which purports to be a kind of guide to the holy land, although it wouldn't actually be very useful if you found yourself on the ground there. But he does include an account of the Islamic Caliph Muawiyah, actually, interestingly, judging a court case between two Christian sects about which one gets to keep a relic of John the Baptist. And he's presented as a sort of Wisdom of Solomon, a good model of good kingship, even though he's called the King of the Saracens and he's he obviously is a Muslim. It's not entirely clear that people in the 7th century understood or imagined or believed that Muslims were not Christians. The earliest references to Muslims not being Christians comes quite late. Indeed, in the 740s, the Greek Orthodox Church declares Islam to be a heresy. And for it to be a heresy, they must imagine it to have been a branch of Christianity. So our concept of being completely of knowledge is something that gradually emerges in this period. So this is what's happening here. By the second half of the 7th century, by the middle of the second half of the 7th century, you're beginning to see, first of all, there's actually a Persian invasion of the East in the 616-620s, and then that's almost immediately followed by the Islamic one in the late 630s onwards. At the same time as that's happening, what we're beginning to see is with the conversion of England, the expansion of the Franks back across the Rhine into their original homeland, and the conversion of peoples there, more stability emerging in the North Sea region. And we see trade routes that now bring exotic goods perhaps up the Danube and down the Rhine and from parts of the interior of Gaul and places like Bavaria and northern Italy, coming through Central Europe, coming to the mouth of the Rhine and similar rivers, and travelling into the North Sea and the top end of the English Channel there. These are the well-established emporia networks. This is not a brilliant map, but I've tried to find a better map, which but was not very successful. I should have left a bit more time to go through books and things to find something that could scan. But the biggest thing was Dorstadt. But places like London, Quaintervik, which is near Tarpe, on the south, on the French coast, Hamwich near modern Southampton, Ipswich, just outside York, Fishergate in York, and perhaps further north, some material of this sort has been found at Dunbar. Looks like it might have been turning into one of these emporia. These were trade centres that in the North Sea and the Channel were mostly occupied by Frisians, itinerant Frisians from the Frisian Islands, who seemed to have controlled the trade between here and between a town called Riba in Denmark, and then trade was passed on to Scandinavians who took it into the Baltic and so on. Eventually, exotic goods from the east would start arriving this way through the Russian river system, and that's really something that doesn't happen until the Viking Age or the beginning of the Viking Age and a bit later on. But what we do see is this strengthening of the east coast, and one of the factors that you see happening in England in this period is that the Kingdom of Mercia, which is basically around Staffordshire, which has spent a lot of the 7th century fighting the Northumbrians and expanding Welsh west against the Welsh, suddenly makes a beeline and takes control of London, just as a little kind of bottom right-hand corner salient, so it can get access to the east coast trade. And this then becomes very important. And similarly, the West Saxons move down to the south coast and have their meat centre around Winchester, which is just upstream from Southampton, which is the major employer in that region. And control of access to prestigious foreign goods coming from the East Coast seems now to be the major factor. Things are going on in Northumbria as well. It's in this same period that Weymouth Jarrow is founded, the monastery that Bede was at, which is not founded until the late 670s. Second half of it is founded in 685, so you're debt to it. And also the Bishop of Hexham, which is on the Tyne. So the Tyne region gets developed in this period, which is Northumbria's main artery, or Northumbria's main artery to the east coast. And so I think what we're seeing here is that Fortrey up here is suddenly becoming the entry point. We're seeing that, if you like, the flow being reversed in the Great Glen. That instead of seeing plunder, slaves and things travelling down the Great Glen and down the coast to Scotland and out of the Highlands to Dalrieta and then meeting international traders there, we're seeing it going the other way. That the international traders will be encountered here indirectly, or perhaps by Northumbrian or Pictish seamen, somewhere in the Moray Firth area. It would be very interesting if we could find some evidence of something like an emporium arising. I'm not sure that we will, because even if you're going along the southern English and French coasts, they do seem to stop about the point where people stop speaking dialects of the Germanic language. And it may be that the Frisians were still needed to have some sort of social engagement with people that they were dealing with, that they didn't like trading with completely foreign. The Frisians could understand Franks and English people and Danes, and so they were happy to deal with them. So it may be that we're not going to, in this period, get fully fledged trading centres of this sort outside of the Germanic language zone. Kentwick's on the mouth of the Conche, which seems to have been the southern limit of Flemish at its greatest extent, just south of Boulogne. But we may find something. Indeed, Martin Carver was attracted to Port Mahomet because there was, in fact, a Frisian coin found there. And he thought he was going to find one of these things, but it was the only part of this sword there, which is quite interesting. You wonder whether somebody took it there knowing it would attract Martin Carver. And then they could get big funding because he's been linked into all sorts of big archaeological projects and this great record and so on. I'm sure that didn't really happen. So what we're seeing here is something like this world system model that people use for understanding the flow of goods in the Mediterranean and so on, but we can apply it on a micro scale to northern Scotland. That we can see the 6th and early 7th centuries as being a period when the Irish Sea and the North Channel is the source of all the wealth and so on that's going into this area. It could even explain why a scion of the most powerful family in Ireland at the time goes off and founds a monastery in the Southern Hebrides. And certainly would explain why Aidan McGavran and his sons were so militarily active. I've also argued elsewhere, and guilty in my unpublished Whittle lecture, that the same thing probably applies to Northumbrian expansion north of the Solway, and that the foundation, that our view of Northumbria is very much skewed by where Bede, our main source, was living. And as I say, that part of Northumbria was only developed heavily, the Tyne Valley, from the late 670s onwards. I think there's probably quite a bit, fair bit of evidence that the North Solway area, what's now South Dumfriesshire, was probably quite early on part of Belicia, and that might well have been that the Belicians were doing the same thing whilst they were based and started on the east coast of somewhere near the modern Anglo-Scottish border. They'd made a beeline in the 6th century for the northern part of the Irish Sea, and places like the Moat of Mark and so on, which turned up there, may well have been quite central to them. It would make sense, perhaps, of their attack on Chester at a period when they still barely controlled Yorkshire, if they were doing it by sea from Solway Basin. And then, of course, what happens in the mid to late 7th century is this trade network just collapses. And the source of power, the source of social power, this leads to civil war inside the boots who had recently been developed, who depended on it, said that late 7th century Dorieta is a turmoil of warring princes. The major dynasties in Ireland who are in control, lose control temporarily, and there's a turmoil there. And we emerge from that with two different dynasties being the two major dynasties in Ireland. And similarly, we see this rapid rise of fortune, a relatively backward pagan area, apparently in the late 6th century, suddenly becoming one of the largest kingdoms in Britain in the decades around 700. And so that's my answer to Chris Wickham. There is more to say about Scottish history than described there as the kingdoms. Thank
left us some time for your questions and possibly his answers and any comments. And you already know the format, so what I invite people to is to put their hands up to indicate.
I've been to school.
But that's just exactly how we'll do this if that's okay, because I'm sure there are probably lots of questions.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask, has nothing been found then for Inverness to have been an emporium? Because always been people settled.
You would think that somewhere around here, we know that Craig Fotheringham, the hill fort just outside of Inverness, was active at this period. And I think I'm right in saying that there's e-ware from there. And there's also b-ware has recently been found at Rhiney, at the very small place that Nova thinks is very important. So I would think that somewhere pretty close to Inverness is likely to be the area. Whether it's actually in Inverness itself, a lot depends on what were good harbours at the time. Very frequently elsewhere, these emporia are not immediately adjacent to major royal centres. They're a little bit apart, and that might be partly because they're largely foreigners, so they're sort of kept a bit to one side. The kind of relationship we're thinking about is the sort of relationship that evolves later between Scone and Perth. Perth is the kind of out-of-town shopping centre for Scone. That's sort of how it would have emerged in the 11th and 12th centuries. And Hamwick, the Anglo-Saxon Hampton, is actually about 12, 15 miles from Winchester, which was the royal centre of the region. Sometimes they're closer to than that, but often they're often in the areas that have recently been acquired from other people, because it's easier to make free and loose with real estate if the sitting tenants don't have the vote. So Southampton had recently been conquered from the Dukes of the Isle of Wight by the West Saxons who'd been based on the Thames before. The Ipswich area may have been detached from Essex by the East Angles, and the biggest one we have in Northumbria is near York, which is at that time ruled by the Bernicene dynasty of Northern Northumbria.
Cromarty, two of the black
arms. Yeah, I mean, you might think somewhere
there. For many centuries, it was the major trading port.
But as far as we know, that's all from about 12th century onwards, maybe later. But we don't know before that. So some of these places, it might be continuity, it might just be absence of documents. Otherwise, it might be, in other cases, it might be that the site's moved. And some of it might be to do with things like silting up and changing. Of course, the size of boats changes. So the places that were good for boats by the 15th century might not have been the places that were ideal for the kind of boats that were going around in this century, which had much shallower drafts, of course, than most of them. So,
like Ephesus, there's six cities in Ephesus.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. And you can think about places like, Liverpool is really Chester moved. Because you can't get modern ships to Chester up the Dee. So they're effectively the same place, but and Hull, in a way, is the mercantile bit of York moved.
Sorry, I'm just aware that
there are a few answers. Two points, really. One, I seem to be the only one who's not convinced that fortune was up here.
I'm sure you're not the only one.
In the later Pictish period, Fortiu and Victoria were certainly in the Irish annals treated as synonymous, really as the same.
More or less.
And Fortiu was quite clearly what you can describe as the capital of Victoria.
But It's mentioned in one source. It's where Kenneth of Halpern died. We don't know anything. We know that kings in this period moved around a lot. I think probably the relationship between Fortiu and Pictavia is like the relationship between Wessex and England, that they become more or less synonymous, that one is the core area. I do think there does seem to be more investment south of the Mount in the 9th century. You do seem to see centres growing up there. But I don't think you can say, I don't think places really had capitals in that sense.
No,
kings tended to move around. I mean, I suspect that Fortiu was actually a church, an ecclesiastical site. It may have had a palace in it as well, but we know that St Andrews did up until the early 12th century. And that was very common on the continent and in Ireland as well. There's a German word for this, Klosterpalast, where it's a palace and a monastery stuck next to each other. And it allows the kings, when they're travelling round, to have a kind of civil service in place. To have their...
Yeah, this was the second point I was wanted to mention. It struck me when I was in Rheine, talking to Arthur Noble, and that really, Pictavia was like a crescent, really, around the mountains. And Rheine was more or less exactly in the middle. Yeah, it's further south than that, because it's just sort of west of Aberdeen. And
it's near to, it's just over the hill from.
No, it's further south.
It's in
Strathbogie.
Anyway, and then I thought, because they were describing it as a kind of royal palace. It's early. It's 15th century.
Yes.
But coming from Germany, and I know that the way the emperors had to migrate, wander around, etc. And I'm sure that the Pictish kings were doing the same thing because you had to show presence, obviously.
I think that's true.
Whereas Rheine was a central staging point.
Well, we know so little that you may be right, but I think at the time that Rheine seems to be flourishing, it's generally thought there wasn't yet a unified Pictish.
That was way on.
The time Rheine was flourishing in the 5th and early 6th centuries, it's usually thought, though perhaps not correctly because we don't know, but it's usually thought that Pictavia had not yet become unified, that there were fragmentary tribes and so on. So the dominant kind of view of present, which is not just down to me, but down to many of the other people working in the field at present, although it hasn't always been the view, is the Fortiu, wherever it's located, expanded and therefore more or less created a unified Pictavia in this late 7th, 8th century, partly on the back of Nectansvir, that having won the Battle of Nectansvir, that it is very like the narrative we get for Alfred and his descendants, uniting England on the back of defeating the Danes, that they're originally kings of just a southern little strip, but because they're the ones who managed to win the big battle against the foreigners, they can then explain their desire for regional hegemony through a narrative about liberation. They can free people. But it is, I have to confess, it's incredibly vague what's going on here. It will be interesting to see what turns up around Rheine. It's certainly an important regional centre, whether it's anything other than the capital of Strathbogie, that sort of little province that it's in. Remains to be seen. Again, it's luck to have been found. There's so many Pictish standing stones standing around that no one thought to dig around and keep settlements. And no one noticed that one for years, even though everyone's known about it and the cross stain has been famous. So we could find half a dozen Rheines in the next 20 years now that we know what to look for.
And to have a Pictish stone in situ is a gift. Eric,
I think you. I was going to ask the Pictavia question that the Jordan man stole me with. Because in one of your maps you had Pictavia writing twice the size of Fortiu and Arthur.
Yes.
You were giving it a lot of status.
Well, I'd say Pictavia is including both. Pictavia is the equivalent of England or Ireland as a concept.
Yeah.
But all of these places have provinces, and the way that in the Dark Ages kingdoms tended to emerge, they tended to emerge by one province dominating its neighbours. And then if it was successful for long enough, people sort of forgot that it was a union of oppression and began to feel that they were full members. You know, I'm sure you're all familiar with similar situations in more recent parts. but it's essentially, it's that most unions You know, we tend to think about the narrative that's often presented in popular nationalist histories of any country, are that the kingdom is kind of united by groups of heroic leaders and so on. So Alfred the Great famously, Kenneth Alpine in Scotland, and various others. But at the time, these guys are usually conquering their neighbours, who may speak a similar dialect to them, but they are, what they see is nasty soldiers coming from the other side of the river. And that's written backwards as a unification, but you can't really unify things that don't already have a unity. So I think Pictavia is the great thing. What James Fraser has argued is that the term Pict itself, which was the Latin term, is picked out of scholarly learning by the kings of Fortune to use as an inclusive term so that the people from K, which is the region up here, Kirkin, Athol, Fife, and so on, so that they feel they're all part of it. It's like, and that's similar to the way that after the Union, but the crowds, particularly in the parliaments, in the term British started being used more widely. If you actually look at the way British is used in the 18th century, it's usually used simply as a synonym for Welsh. So it started being used explicitly to avoid saying English because it might alienate the Irish and the Scots from the national project. And that's something that's sort of a conscious decision by policymakers and ideologues in the United Kingdom. It's a way of making the Irish and the Scots feel that they're on board, they're team members, and not just auxiliaries.
Do we have other questions or comments? So I see two. So maybe yourself and then James after.
Okay.
I think that might bring us to our limit, but we'll see. Yes.
I'm interested in your comments about the Frisians. Emporia not being found necessarily where trade was arriving.
No, so they are found where trade, they are found where kings are.
That's right, yeah. I wonder if I might make the suggestion that we're perhaps underestimating the seamanship of Pictish sailors, and in fact they may be heading eastwards and bringing the trade back themselves.
It's possible that some Picts are involved. I mean, certainly other people did say, but we've got no evidence of that.
No.
I think there is a little bit of very slim, but to me, credible evidence that there's contact between Shetland and Norway in the pre-Viking age. I'm sure they knew these places were there, were capable of sailing there, but I think one of the things that allowed the Frisians to do this was that they actually had a network, a social network. So it's a little bit like Jews and Armenians in early modern Europe. But they were able to go back and forth because they had relatives and so on in all the ports.
I think I would be interested in I don't know, some practical reconstructive archaeology, but they actually looked at the logistics of a Pictish force being conveyed to Orkney and how the technology.
It would be interesting to do that. I was thinking about that the other day. I've been reading a couple of books published by the Viking Ship Museum in Roskilde. They do lots of this stuff around the Baltic and so on. And I was thinking, God, we could get people to do that in these islands. It seemed, I mean, obviously, it can't be that hard because the Vikings did it all the time. And I imagine that what's surprising about the two attacks on Orkney that we had here, that they were large-scale attacks led by kings, not that people could sail to Orkney. I mean, obviously people could sail to Orkney, it's not that far away. And the ships seemed, there are a number of accounts of Pictish fleets, even Pictish going to Ireland and so on. Jonathan Wooding has done some work on what the ships actually would have looked like. The Sherlock's Fen Harbour, which is a text from Don Rieta, describes the boats as being seven benches, and they're probably clinker-built boats, or maybe, what's the other one called? Carving-built boats. So it's also planks, but not overlapping. With seven benches probably means there may be 15 people aboard, which is interestingly the number of people in Beowulf's boat. Yeah, in Beowulf, he's said to be one of 15 in his boat. So I don't think they would have had problems sailing long distances. I think it's not so much about technology, it's about motivation, social networks that need to be secure when you end up on an alien beach. I suspect one of the reasons the Frisians didn't like going beyond the Germanic language zone is that if they did end up going a bit off course and ending up somewhere where they didn't know where they were, they wanted to be able to explain to people. who they were and why they were and so on. And having to talk to French people, Bretons or worse this year.
Wasn't there a report once of a Pictish raid on the Bristol Channel or something?
There is. Oh, that's interesting. There's a poem. There's a poem.
Sorry.
There's a Welsh poem about the town that's now called Tenby, Dinbych, which does actually mention some of that Pictish raiders out in the sea. And that's often puzzled people because it's the only kind of thing. But we do know there were British naval attacks in the north of Ireland and so on. So it's not. And everyone else was travelling all over the place. So there's no reason for thinking they couldn't do it. And certainly there were people sailing from sort of Lindisfarne to Pictavia in the 8th century. So I don't think there's any impediment to the Picts sailing around. Whether they were the main players in trade is perhaps less likely for a variety of reasons that are not mentioned and the social networking being managed.
I promised James the last call from the floor.
Okay. Should be quite a brief question. You spoke about the collapse of the Mediterranean trade network in the 7th century, which coincided with a kind of fall of Dalriada and then the rise of Fortru. I just wonder what was the reason for that?
Well, it's largely the Islamic conquests, and they partly just disrupt, and also the war between Persia and Byzantium that we preceded there. It's partly that they actually disrupt what's going on, and partly that they then start drawing the product of those regions back into the heartland of the Islamic world, Assyria and Iraq, rather than into the West. Probably, and I'm not sure, as I keep meaning to look this up, is we just know where one of the major drivers of the Mediterranean people trading with Western Britain is tin and copper. And I wonder where the Islamic Empire, the Caliphate, got most of its tin and copper. I think there's tin in Yemen, but that's a vague memory from somewhere. But I need to look at that, so they might not have needed that. One of the flip sides of this that was suggested many years ago by Wilhelm Leveson was that it may be the reason the Dark Age ends in textual terms, the really dark period of ancient history is the sort of 5th, 6th and early 7th centuries, particularly 5th and 6th centuries. And Leveson suggested that one of the things that stopped coming north was papyrus. And that led to people using parchment, sheepskin, much more for writing on. And parchment is much more durable than papyrus, particularly in wet climates. And it's been argued that the earliest surviving Anglo-Saxon charters date from the 670s, but we can tell that they belong to a tradition that must have been introduced at the beginning of the 7th century or late 6th century by St. Augustine, the Italian missionaries, because they use an Italian style and so on. But no charters survive before that 670s, and Leveson suggests this might be that the earliest charters might be written on papyrus that had no chance of surviving. And that might be one of the reasons why so little textual material survives from 5th, 6th, and early 7th century. It may be a bit of a push to put it all on that, but it may be a factor in there.
Just the age of the book.
Yes.
Thank you, Alex. Thank you so much. Unlike the Frisians perhaps arriving on soils where they may not have had friendly ears, I think this has all fallen on incredibly welcoming ears. I feel we're in the middle of a millennial, many millennial conversation, that this dialogue will continue, and I hope that we may invite you back into conversation with us.
Well, of course, this is an area where a handful of new archaeological finds could change everything, so that's
so feel inspired. But remember your treasure trove lore as well. Thank you so much for being a very warm and welcoming and attentive audience. These sort of opportunities occur regularly at Inverness Museum and Art Gallery, and if you have enjoyed this afternoon and you think you'd like to explore more of what we do here, we do have a website and we have a button which says keep up to date. If you click that, you can find the means by which you receive regular news about events, activities, lectures, exhibitions and so forth. Can I ask you one more time to give our thanks to Alex.